What are metformin side effects for diabetics? We know it's prescribed for type 2 diabetes. What about type 1 or even type 1.5, latent, LADA diabetics such as myself that are insulin dependent? Or what about pre-diabetes? What are the latest updates? Today, we will cover a very important new study related to why I, even though an insulin-dependent diabetic with no resistance issues, would continue to take this life-saving medication for the rest of my life. No questions asked anymore. Because this study, which we will cover today, validated what I've known to be true. I will also throw in an added bonus. What are three natural ways to easily increase insulin sensitivity without the use of any medications? And these methods are powerful. But before we begin, let me welcome all those new Brazilian diabetics out there. This is where we turn ordinary struggling diabetics into extraordinary well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you're brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 5 years ago, the proud owner of a pancreas that has gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I diabetic like you, where we'll be walking the walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that does come in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. If you like what you see here today and you want to learn more, I suggest you hit that subscribe button, that like button, and of course the notification icon, which is the gray bell. That is so you don't miss a second of those upcoming episodes that will change your life. More than 29 million Americans have diabetes, and every 23 seconds another new one is diagnosed. So doctors have prescribed metformin to nearly 120 million people worldwide. It is one of the first diabetic medications that is prescribed generally right after diagnosis. And that was my case too. So right after I was diagnosed, and actually I was misdiagnosed as a type 2, I was put on metformin immediately. And I initially saw how powerful this compound was at moderating blood sugars, especially when combined with exercise. But I was not suffering from resistance or sensitivity issues like a type 2 would. So metformin by itself was not quite the answer for me. That is because my pancreas had stopped producing insulin. So my blood sugar still remained high until I was prescribed insulin, both a long acting for my basal background needs and a short version for my direct food requirements. That combination is what has my A1C on the last test at about 5.1, feeling great, looking fit and energetic throughout the day. And I must say, metformin has been a big, big part of my success story and will continue to be. What were my side effects which match the most common ones that are reported today? Bloating, gas, loose stools, and diarrhea. If you are new to metformin and this happens, first, you got to report that to your doctor. Your doctor would more likely have you readjust those doses down at first, starting with the smallest possible dose at dinner. And then your doctor will probably have you increase the amounts by maybe 500 milligrams per week and until your intestinal tract becomes accustomed to the required dose. The other option you can have if this continues and you are still facing problems is to have your doctor look into what's known as an extended release version. Metformin doesn't immediately lower blood sugars. It can take a week or two to experience the full effect, and that's all highly dependent on the dose you're given. It will not solve all of your problems in a blink of an eye. It just doesn't quite work like that. But it is a very effective and it is a very cheap medicine. Metformin has to be used with the proper diet and exercise program and possibly with other medications to control high blood sugars, depending again on your unique diagnosis. So the next question is, how does metformin work? Its interactions with the body is complex, but it's truly very, very interesting. In type 2 diabetes, the cells in the body, particularly the muscle, fat, and liver cells become what's known as resistant to the actions of insulin. Insulin, as you may know, is a hormone responsible for controlling the levels of sugars and glucose, basically, in the blood. It opens those cell doors to allow the movement of sugars from the blood into those cells. When the cells are resistant to insulin, this makes the blood sugar levels begin to rise, and it begins to rise at exceptionally high levels. And that's where your body now has to produce more and more insulin to get the job done, thus creating another host of deadly health problems. First, what it does is it increases the sensitivity of cells to insulin. This enables those cells to remove sugars from the blood more effectively. Second, it reduces the amount of sugar produced by the cells, specifically the liver, that gets dumped into the bloodstream, especially at night. Finally, it delays the absorption of sugars from the intestines into the bloodstream after eating, so there is less of a spike of blood sugars generally after a meal. And that is great. Now, what about the rest of us, the non-type 2 diabetics? What is the appropriateness of metformin for people with type 1 or type 1.5 diabetics such as myself, given the potential for coexisting lactic acidosis and diabetic ketoacidosis? Do I need it? That's the big question of the day. In other words, would it benefit all of us? Metformin is not currently approved for use in type 1 diabetes, but people have been known to take this medication anyways. Many doctors do prescribe it if someone is type 1 and is generally overweight. The study we will discuss today is what I found of great interest, and it's called The Effects of Metformin in Type 1 Diabetes Mellitus, and it was published in 2018. 29 adults with type 1 diabetes who had metformin added to their insulin therapy for about 12 months, 1 year, were compared to exactly the same amount, 29 adults with type 1 diabetes who remained just on insulin alone. The mean metformin dose was around 2,100 milligrams per day. They wanted to test insulin resistance, which, as we know, leads to poor glycemic control and chronic complications in type 1. Metabolic syndrome is the clinical name for insulin resistance. Type 1 diabetes associated with metabolic syndrome has been termed the name double diabetes. So what is metabolic syndrome? Well, metabolic syndrome is a cluster of conditions that occur generally together. They increase our risk of heart disease and stroke. These conditions include high blood pressure, high blood sugars, excessive body fat around the waist, and abnormal cholesterol and triglyceride levels. So basically, they wanted to test the theory that if metformin increases sensitivity, then that would lead to reduction of insulin dose requirements, thus weight and fat gain. So why is this important? I've mentioned this on a multitude of videos. We as diabetics want two things, two critical factors. First, control blood sugars. Two, we have to use or have our bodies produce just enough insulin to keep us healthy, fit, and energetic. Too much insulin in conjunction to the high blood sugars is what's really causing most of our health issues. What were the results after 1 year? Insulin dose requirements decreased in the metformin insulin group, whereas insulin dose requirements was slightly increased in the insulin alone group over the same time period. So it showed metformin helped with insulin sensitivity, which will normally creep up over time. Metabolic syndrome markers did not differ between the metformin insulin group and the insulin only group before the treatment, but was significantly decreased in the metformin insulin group compared to the insulin group after the treatment. Body weight and waist circumference was reduced in the metformin insulin group, where they both increased in the insulin only group. What about fasting glucose and postprandial glucose? For those who may not know what postprandial glucose is, that will be the blood glucose in the blood after a meal. There was a decrease in fasting glucose and postprandial glucose in the metformin insulin group after the treatment. Both crept up in the insulin only group. So that meant the body was more efficient at absorbing blood glucose during the day. So the bottom line, which we already knew, metformin increases insulin sensitivity. It reduces insulin resistance, improves insulin action, and increases peripheral glucose uptake in those type 1 diabetics. Where the study differed from a lot of previous studies was the lipid profiles. Now, previous studies reported that metformin improved blood lipid profiles. This present study suggested that metformin reduced glucose concentrations, decreased insulin dose requirements, but without improving blood lipids. And I actually already knew that. Metformin has no effect on my cholesterol, my LDL, my triglycerides, nor did it have any effect on the subjects in the study. Those markers that I mentioned before are related to total insulin requirements. So the more insulin I need, the worse my health markers. And that is even consuming, and in my opinion, over consuming those healthy carbs our diabetic healthcare experts are recommending these days. This is why doctors have many of us diabetics concurrently on statins. And statins do work directly on lowering cholesterol levels. Even if I were a type 2 or pre-diabetic with controlled blood sugars and the doctor still wanted you on metformin based on these studies, I would. As you can see, it will leverage your health markers far greater than without. And that is why I'm on it and I will continue to take it even if my doctor said I do not need it anymore. So what are the added bonuses? What are the other things you can do to bring up insulin sensitivity and substantially? The most powerful way is exercise. Combine that with metformin, 1 + 1 = 2. Those two are 1 + 1 = 8. And what I mean by exercise, I mean both types of exercise, aerobic and anaerobic. What I mean by anaerobic, that would be weight training. This is one of the reasons I look the way I do. The metformin and resistance weight training is a powerful, powerful combination. A second way you can do things to increase insulin sensitivity is to cycle your carb intake. A few days where you drop or lower your carb intake followed by your normal intake. Third way of doing things is called intermittent fasting. But this requires a very experienced diabetic who is very well structured and knows exactly what foods to be eaten. And we will talk about all three of these factors in much, much greater detail in upcoming episodes. But you're going to have to subscribe to this channel and hit that gray bell if you want to be alerted to when they are published. In the comment section below, please tell me how you responded to metformin. Did you suffer from or are you still suffering from the gastrointestinal issues? How did you resolve them? I will also create a link for you related to what we can and cannot eat. Now, at the top of the list, there's a brand new video dedicated to our doctors, their true limitations. And what's in that video, if you haven't seen it yet, will shock you. And I'll put it right there for you. If you're on a desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're on your mobile device, just tap that with your fingers. So have a great day, a productive day, and we'll see you with another episode, which I said are always released weekly. Bye for now, folks.